Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. It is time for DreamHack Stockholm. This is it, the Counter-Strike Global Offensive Tournament to be played out in Globen. I'm too excited because that is one of the most epic intro videos ever. I'm in love with Crims, man.
There's a number of things that are really impressive about that video. Crims is one of them. I'm surprised that anyone was able to film Forrest for that long without him cracking a smile. That's impressive. I'm impressed by how much it looked like Get Right could actually be in a boy band. That too, man.
And that I lean, love it. That casual lean on the down, yeah. Man.
And
really.
It, you know, Fuflaren trying really hard to look really hard. Fuflaren is one of the nicest person, people in the whole world. So, yeah. You know, he has to try really hard, I imagine. It's really fun.
It's so good, man. It's so good. But that's the thing. Video. We don't know how many takes went into it with Forrest. Maybe take 556, so they finally got it right where he wasn't smiling at somebody.
I have to imagine that's basically it. It's a really good video, a really good idea. I hope DreamHack are going to do more stuff like this.
Yeah.
This is really enjoyable.
Oh, this is really cool. And I mean, it just gets the hype going because this is going to be so sick, Anders. We were talking about it a lot last night in the broadcast, but this is going to be played out in Globen, the Globen Arena right here in Stockholm. This thing is gigantic.
The video says, "Welcome to Sweden, home of Counter-Strike." Don't even think that's anywhere near an exaggeration, but I put it one step further. I think I've said this in the past as well. I think Sweden is almost like the esports capital of Europe. Maybe if you go to Korea, you can find some heavy esports influence. But Sweden is the place to be. A sick country when it comes to esports. And Counter-Strike has an ancient history, obviously. NiP being not a brand that's exclusive to Global Offensive, but it's gone back quite a while. Fnatic too.
They're here, man. And I mean, hell, just last night we were watching Set play. Heaton, I'm sure, is going to be behind his boys over Inferno. The guys are going to be playing out at Inferno Online, also one of the biggest LANs in Europe. So it's quite cool to see that we're going to be able to play everything out over there. So if you're in the Stockholm area, if you are around here today and tomorrow, you got to come to Stockholm and you've got to see these guys play because they're going to be right there. You're going to get to get up right behind them and watch everything happen right in front of you. But also tomorrow in the Globen Arena, that's something to look forward to, man. You could fit like 5, 6, 7, I don't know how many thousands of people in there, but I'm sure it's going to be packed.
It will be quite insane. And I'm happy that we do have a camera over at Inferno Online just checking everything out. And
there they are.
The NiP team setting up. And Peter in the background, you're right. Definitely one of the sort of top contenders to take the title here. Mm-hmm. Fnatic maybe being the other one, but I would say the chances for an upset are really, really big at this tournament.
Yeah, no, it's so tough to call exactly with how well Fnatic have been playing online. I mean, NiP seem to be their nemesis. They beat them at Gamescom. They broke their online streak that Fnatic had running for quite some time there throughout the month of September, and it was NiP that stopped them. So are they going to be able to do it again here online? Are NiP going to have just that secret to beat Fnatic? Because it doesn't look like anybody else knows how to do it.
Well, I mean, I don't know. I think there is... It's also a chance that one of the new French teams could do it, and I think there's a good chance that Dignus House could do it too. You know, I have to say that obviously.
You're trying to make me happy saying that.
You know, it's not just the Copenhagen Wolves and Dignus House that have traveled from Denmark to Sweden. I'm here too, so you know, we have a bit of a presence to try and see if we can challenge.
There's 11 Danes in Stockholm right now.
At least 11, right? There's probably a few more, but.
But you're right, man. LDLC and Titan, and that's going to be our next match of the day as well. So that's going to be so sick. I can't wait to see that because there's just so much riding on that match. Read an interview from NBK this morning, and he's saying, "Yeah, we're out for blood. This is going to prove who made the right choice. Like, how hard of a statement is that? Who made the right choice when we decided to reshuffle the teams?"
Yeah, and of course, the first game is going to be NiP and alternate, and we're seeing some of the alternate team here anyway setting up. I think they've got B playing, right? Mm-hmm. Which is really exciting. I mean, I feel like we can't overhype him too much just because it's going to be a little bit unfair. His time in Global Offensive has been, you know, not anywhere near what NiP has been putting in.
Yeah.
But his name as a strat caller in 1.6 is quite legendary.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I can't wait to hear actually what Thorin will have to say about that. I don't think he's going to be joining us today, but he will be here tomorrow for sure for the main event in Globen, where the semis and the finals will be played out. So if Alternate were to make it through the group, he's going to have loads of things to say about God B, because that guy's certainly got a history.
Yep.
But I mean, Alternate's still a tough team to go into this, but not going to be the favorites here in this match. I think everybody would say, you know, NiP, pretty much clear favorites to make it out of this group, although each group just looks so tough.
But there's another thing to consider here, which is the fact that NiP, historically speaking, has always been a little bit shaky when it comes to group stages,
mm-hmm.
and especially their first matches. So, and it's best of one format. So I don't think you can't just rely on NiP just destroying alternate. I would say Yeah, 9 times out of 10, sure. But, you know, there is that 10th time.
And the format, I don't think we've changed it. It's going to be, you know, best of ones, essentially. You know, you've got the first match to start things off, and then we go into the winner match to see who gets the first seed in the group. But then you have the loser match to see who's going to be the first team out, and then the consolidation match for that second seed. So it's the same format that we've used at all the majors and in DreamHack in the past. So just so you guys know, that's how things are going to roll here. But the first match is going to be NiP versus Alternate. The second match after this is going to be LDLC versus Titan. But we just got word that the map is going to be Inferno. So, you know, Counter-Strike Inferno Offensive, pretty much, Anders. Like, we're going to get to see lots of chickens and fish.
Yes, best of one format. That's just what it is down to. It's a safe choice for almost any team. And against NiP, it's also really difficult. If you wanted to throw a curveball and ban out Inferno, you know, you might end up playing on Nuke or something like that. And if you're Alternate, pretty not really fun at all.
No. Yeah, pretty much I think that's like maybe the last map you want to play NiP on, Nuke. But then again, we still have in this format here, it's going to be a 7-map pool, and we're going to have Overpass and Cobble in here, as well as Cash. Train is not in the group. We're using the major tournament format here, so the major map pool. And so there's still some options out there. I'm wondering how much time these teams have been able to put into those new maps since the major, because I'm really excited to see another team play out on Overpass or Cobble.
Yeah, I think they have put in a reasonable amount of time, actually. I think it's still going to be a long time before we start to see a lot of teams feel very comfortable on those maps. It does take... I mean, that has nothing to do with how much time they're putting in. It's just that's how long it takes for people to get into a certain routine, and then for another team to break that routine and figure out how to destroy it.
Sure.
That's what the meta game means, you know. It's you know, one team getting comfortable with something and then another team figuring out how to stop it.
And these guys, I mean, it doesn't take them long to figure these things out either, you know. Well, from one day to the next, the way that the map is played can be changed completely. You know, Overpass comes to mind with Connector and figuring out that you could actually jump on the wall of B site and see over in there. And then all of a sudden, that place that we thought that was going to be the hot spot on the map, it gets completely ignored. So one day to the next, and now we get to see actually land play on these maps once again. So I'm really excited about this. It's going to be a lot of fun to see how these teams have adapted to the new maps.
Yeah, it definitely will be. And how much they're going to get picked or put in as well. I mean, obviously, once we get into best of three territory later on.
I think it's definitely going to come up in the best of three territory. Like, I would be amazed, actually, if we didn't at least see Overpass. Cobble, maybe not, especially since it's been changed recently. So who knows how much time the teams have actually put in on that map, you know, despite the fact that it's been changed. But Overpass, I think teams are getting more and more comfortable on that map.
So, if you had to pick a team, just without having seen them yet, it's been a while since we've seen them online. We only have online evidence to go by, which is really not good evidence at all to judge by.
Yeah.
You can be completely different. So, it's a little bit unfair to ask the question before we see anyone, but it's still kind of fun. If you had to pick a team, you can go with the safe choice if you prefer.
Man, well, as far as I'm concerned, at least going into it, the French shuffle, because right now in this group, we have the two French teams, and in Group B, we have the two Danish teams. So it's going to be a bit rough for the French and Dane fans. Only one of your teams is going to make it out of the groups this time around, because it's top two teams advancing. But it's, you know, it's going to be NiP making it out. I think we can all be pretty clear about that. But who's going to make it out from the French teams? Is it going to be Titan or LDLC? And honestly, I might go with... Everybody's going to say it's crazy, but I'm going to go with LDLC, actually.
All right. Well, I mean, I think yesterday when Shoxi played, did he drop like 38 kills or something like that?
Well, you know what's crazy is that if he can drop 38 kills while leading, that's something to be good to be writing home to mom about. Because NBK said that apparently, you know, we all knew that he did start out calling on the team, but that they rapidly changed it up, and it's now Shoxi who's calling the shots on that team with input from NBK, with input from Happy. But Shoxi's the one running the show now for LDLC, so he's got some experience leading, and I think that's going to help them certainly, because we did see, you know, his team, Epsilon, get into the round of 8 at Gamescom. So he's got that major experience with the captain hat on.
Yeah, now what's worth noting about the Epsilon team where Shoxi was part of it is that, you know, he was doing the leading there as well, but one of the really difficult things that he had to deal with was not just leading, but also trying to coach and guide new players that needed maybe a lot of coaching and guiding. Not because they needed, you know, help at shooting people, but they needed to know when to do the right thing. And I think on this current LDLC lineup, there's a lot more individual strength in terms of making decisions on someone like MBK. You don't really need to tell him when to do what he does. He just knows it. So Shox gets a little bit of time off from doing that, and he can focus on the overall picture a little bit more. So I think actually his in-game leading role has become a little bit easier in this LDLC team. And that's good, because they do need him to drop 30, 40 bombs sometimes.
Yeah, you know, we want to see that big play from Shoxi, but you're hitting it right on the head because there's still Smith, there's NBK, there's Happy, and Kiyoshima is a real terror as well. So he's kind of the guy who needs a little bit more experience on the team. The other three members, apart from Shoxi, have got mountains of it. So you're right. You know, Shoxi's definitely going to be feeling more comfortable in this sort of scene, in this sort of team, especially with his whole team having so much experience.
Yeah.
But we should maybe be like saving this talk for when they play, because they're actually going to be playing next. It's going to be at 13:30 that we're going to get to see Titan LDLC played out here.
I'm sure by then a lot more people have tuned in. Anyway, it's kind of early in Central Europe, at least if you're a computer gamer, it could be a little bit stressful to get up this soon. And we'll go over it again. For my pick, I'm going to have to go with Dignitas here. I feel like it's about time that the Danes make it through a semifinals and come out and do it.
Okay. I thought we were going groups-wise. Group
the whole thing.
Group B, I wouldn't be surprised to see Fnatic and Dignitas make it out, because that's Fnatic is the other Swedish team that's in Group B, and then you have both of the Danish teams. So you have Dignitas and Copenhagen Wolves. So yeah, Fnatic, Dignitas, I think are going to be the pretty clear favorites to make it out of there.
Yeah, but by no means guaranteed, I would say.
No,
you gotta be careful about that. The other team that's here is obviously Alternate, one of them, and then 3D Max, the Finnish team.
Yeah,
it's also here with Natu and the rest of them.
Here.
Actually a really excited signing team. I think the Finns have always had like a really strong talent pool, and a lot of them are in this team. Not all of them. Some of them are, some of the Finnish talent is sort of weirdly missing on it. Alu being one, Aslak, who can't seem to actually want to play the game like full time. Nasu, which is Lerpa's brother, also out there somewhere. Very talented guy as well. And but still, this constellation of players could be really good. Lately I've been really excited about how well Xart's been playing.
No doubt.
Really strong.
Him and Disturbed as well. He's been doing good things. Corona is also on that team, and he's always been very consistent. Yeah. So Natu always seems to be the driving force, though. You know, he's the guy with the most experience. He's also getting on in the years, but he's certainly always shown that he's capable of even top fragging for his team.
Yeah.
So it's going to be cool to see 3D Max on land. Natu's got so much experience for them.
You know, I caught a tweet from Natu earlier, minutes ago, saying he got to the Globen Hotel and it was time for a nap. So. Oh, I love it.
I wonder if he took the ferry over, if they took the ferry over for this trip.
Yeah. just to make it nice and smooth, comfortable.
Yeah. Drink lots of Lunken.
Yeah. Wonderful stuff.
Good times.
So getting into this game, of course, we're not quite ready yet, but we did see some pictures earlier of the team setting up, and they weren't looking like they were just on the edge. Looked like they were just sorting out a couple of issues at the end there. Alternate, German team. And Germans generally, when it comes to LAN play, they've been struggling a little bit with that. There's been some exceptions, it wasn't really a full German lineup, the Mousesports lineup with Alu and Chris and everything, but at Gfinity they actually did really well and impressed a lot of people. But then it seems like since then they've still been struggling on LAN, like the German EPS finals, they ended up not winning to everyone's surprise. And so I don't know, I think it's still... It's still sort of a thing where the German scene in general has to overcome that and try and see if they can't do better, and I'm sure they can.
But yeah, this is... it's always going to be them trying to get just more and more experience, because I don't think that they're able to practice as much, obviously, as the other teams as well, that they kind of try and catch up in that sense. So Alternate are always going to be the underdogs, but we have seen them play in the past up to a level where even they made NiP have to work for a map. Yeah. So we couldn't expect some big things from them, but going into this, I think all eyes are going to be turned to NiP and really seeing what kind of shape NiP are going into to start things off in this tournament, because all eyes are going to be on the last major winners.
Yeah, and I don't know. It feels to me like NiP are playing better and better recently.
Yeah, I'm just wondering if it's like old Fnatic, where it's like they get onto LAN and all of a sudden they go up a notch, right?
It could be.
Because the online has been kind of wishy-washy lately for their online play.
I often find myself thinking about the Gamescom tournament and how on earth NiP managed to win it at all, because that was not the strongest iteration of NiP we've ever seen. But then... Peter as the coach, I think now he's actually had a lot of time to work with the team. And I wouldn't be surprised if that's going to come in quite heavily here in, here and in future tournaments too, because at Gamescom he had only just been put on.
True.
And he had very little time to do much of anything, right? He was just there doing the best he could, but I think maybe Peter in full effect could make a big difference. Not so much against a team like Alternate. I don't think Alternate are high on NiP list of, wanting to figure out and counter-strat and all that stuff. But against some of the tougher teams, I think it could be a factor. Wouldn't be surprised.
It'll really make a difference. Like, it's Inception.
Well, Devilwalk is a spy. He's actually in the NiP camp.
Well, Devil Walk, that's the thing. That's why Devil Walk, I'm convinced this whole nice guy thing is just an act. It allows him to get close to his opponents, get close to his teams. He's the coach now, too, so he can get in there, get the info, and then relay that all back to Pronax.
Do you think while they're talking, he's...
But funny, you know, we're joking about it, but actually Devil Walk and Exist come from the same town, and they're really close friends. So there was a picture on Twitter not too long ago where Exist was wearing a Fnatic hat. Devil Walk had managed to put a Fnatic hat on Exist, and we were all crying for fines, basically. Valve fined them $2,500. But I don't know what happened there. I don't think it happened. I'm a bit disappointed in Valve. They need to keep their players straight, right?
Yeah. I'm not sure how much information you can really gather on someone who's just like in the Counter-Strike lobby, but you can try at least. It's a nice effort, Devil
yeah.
Walk. Good, well played.
I imagine we're going to be getting into the match fairly soon here, because we do know that the map is Inferno. And so this has always been one of NiP's stronger maps. I think right now, at least, their level on Inferno is not too shabby.
No,
so going into it, it's actually a pretty good start. I imagine Alternate have got plenty of strats figured out for this map as well. It's always kind of it's like this map and Dust 2 are always going to be go-to maps for any team practically, because they're going to have the most experience on it and they're going to have figured out quite a few strats for it. So if you're going to start off your tournament, Inferno is probably a pretty safe bet. You're not taking any kind of insane risk of like playing NiP on Nuke or something like that, where maybe if you have a really strong CT side, you can eke out the win, but then you know, it could go the other way very quickly. Yeah. So Inferno definitely feels like the smart choice for both teams to start this off on.
Yeah, definitely. I think Alternate need everything they can. Normally, we're not too excited about knife rounds and stuff like that on Inferno, but I think Alternate do need to start on the CT side, or prefer to start on the CT side, and then, I don't know, there's going to be a lot of stuff that has to hit just right for the Alternate team. But, I mean, I guess the one advantage they might have is that like I was talking about here, NiP probably haven't, like, you know, on the NiP radar, Alternate is just a really tiny blip somewhere out in the the peripherals here. They're not really that excited about, you know, playing Alternate. They're going to be focusing on Fnatic, first of all, Dignitas second in line, and then the French teams, I think. That's the order in which NiP are prioritizing right now.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's the surprise factor. What if Alternate have secretly been, you know, planning and preparing and are, you know, a little bit better than NiP might suspect?
That's the thing. And Alternate have been known to do that in the past as well, where they potentially catch, you know, these clear favorites to take the map, and they catch them off guard and actually make them really struggle to take that map. Yeah. So Alternate are absolutely capable of rolling in here and actually doing some damage to NiP. And can you imagine, like, the complete, and like the a million voices crying out in the Nether, you know, just that if Alternate managed to take this map, what a way to start the tournament. NiP, I mean, NiP are the teams to bounce it back, but that would turn this entire group on its head, because then all of a sudden you've got, you know, Titan, LDLC, you know, they're fighting for second seed. You have NiP fighting for second seed. How incredible would that be?
It'd be pretty strange, I say.
I think it's going to have to take, like, we're going to have to look at, like, Titan or LDLC and see if they're capable of it. NBK is very confident in their ability to beat NiP. They really think that they can do it, and that's NBK from LDLC. So going into that match, if LDLC managed to take out Titan, that winner match is going to be ridiculous. If NiP and LDLC are in it, I mean, similar styles, similar game styles. LDLC have based their way of playing CS on NiP, on the pick and play, basically, you know, a lot of momentum going and just looking out, getting map control and going for picks. That's what LDLC are all about right now.
Yeah.
And they based a lot of that on what NiP do. But NiP, like you said, they've had more time with PETA now. They've had a lot of time to develop their game since Gamescom.
Yeah.
So are they going to have anything special to show us here now that we're on LAN?
Well, I think what PETA can add to a team, or that goes for Devil Walk or anyone else too, who's sort of stepping in as a coach. I mean, Dignitas have their coach with them, 32K.
Who's the
Source player, really well known as well in Danish circles, I think outside too. I think what you can have when you have a coach like that is you can have someone who can keep like an overall picture. Because when you're in the game, even if you're the strat caller, let's say you lose 5 rounds and, you know, out of 15 to a particular kind of style, you don't notice that it's happening, but it is happening, right? They keep doing the same thing. Like yesterday when we were casting a Case King tournament, we did notice that, you know, what some of the teams like Property, for instance, what they ended up doing a lot was once they got the entry frank, they just get full on aggression, right? They never stopped. They got a first kill and then they just went with it. And if you don't notice that when you're in the game, if your focus is on something else, that sixth guy on your team who's, you know, looking at it could be the guy to just step in and say, like, I don't think someone like Peter's going to be talking all the time to the NiP team.
No.
But if you can step in every once in a while and say, guys, it seems like, you know, this thing is happening, that could be enough information for the actual in-game leader to make his job a little bit easier. And then, I mean, from watching Peter at Gamescom, I know that he was spending a lot of time looking at demos. and figuring out timings, which is really important. Right?
You can be sure that this, that a lot of time is spent basically going over demos, probably his team's demos more than anybody else, but he's still at, he's still that sixth man who can basically not have to just sit there and prac and do the muscle memory things, you know, go into all sorts of things. You know, the time that you have to invest into the game, apart from just playing these official matches, is obscene. Learning smokes, learning flashes, making sure that your aim is right, all of this takes up a lot of time. So PETA, as a coach, doesn't have to do any of that. All he has to do is focus on making sure that his team's game is up to snuff, but also if he can get his hands on anything else. Like, if they know this match going into this, they've had a few days now to know the groups. They look at it and they're like, okay, we're going to play alternate first, and then there's Titan and LDLC. PETA, in these days leading up, can basically go through a bunch of demos, see what the latest match results were for those teams, see how they played them out, and then have a meeting with Exist and be like, okay, here's the information you need. You were able to focus on your game this whole time, and now I'm going to bring you what you need to basically beat these teams. So having a sixth man on that team, I mean, as a coach, is huge. Is a huge advantage. And Devilwalk does the same thing for Fnatic. And Fnatic have definitely played so much better since they've gone for that lineup change.
Yeah, I mean, it's in the details when you're playing at this level, essentially. So, you know, if there's 40 seconds on the clock left, you see a particular smoke coming in, and you've already been studying that. You know, all right, this team we're playing against, they love to throw, you know, a smoke towards whatever point on the map at exactly 40 seconds. Or that's an unfortunate pattern, because no team would really want to you know, signal that much. I think every team will want to try and throw off by even just a couple of seconds, just so there's that, you know, element of doubt in the other team. You're thinking, is it the same thing they're doing this time? Like, that's the mind game that's going into it. And I mean, it's very, very hard to catch once we're actually in the game. But if we had a chance to interview, we should try and do interviews with Peter and Devilwalk in the future to figure out exactly how this stuff works. Because it's a lot of fun.
That's the thing. This is information that teams never will discuss. Because unless it's very just broad sort of stuff, because sometimes teams don't even realize when they have tells, basically. And so they're gonna probably discuss other teams' tells, but at that same time, they're giving away information, and basically they're giving away information that's going to allow that other team to better itself. And that's the last thing as a competitor you want to do.
Yeah.
So there was some already, you know, we can talk about some of the older teams' tells because, you know, reasons, right? They're not there anymore. Ooh. But like old Very Games, there's Grey Karn, the man who makes DreamHack happen, the head honcho. He is there.
Yeah. He looks really humble as well. You don't realize that all of DreamHack is
on his shoulders, on those skinny hipster shoulders, right there, Grey Karn.
One guy. And that guy right there looking really
handsome.
We have
the two kings.
That is Peter from HLTV.org, who is the guy almost totally responsible for running the site, and a very, very cool guy. So yeah, shout out to Peter for being awesome.
Yeah,
they're really cool. For the HLTV's actually here covering everything as well, so
they are here. They're here with the whole crew, so we're gonna get go to HLTV.org. you guys can check out all the match posts and the videos as well. They're gonna be working around the clock. They always do. These guys, like Peter, is one of those guys we've been talking about a lot recently between you and I, but like, he's the guy who will stay up and do all of the European matches and make sure everything is updated, and then he'll stay up all night and do the American matches too.
Yeah,
and he'll sleep a couple hours during the day and then start it all over again. Like, he is dedicated.
No doubt, if you prefer your news in Swedish, you can always go to frackby.se, which is a really good site. Or if you're clever enough to use Google Translate, that site also works right there. It's hard, really hard, but sometimes it, you know, you can do it.
Frackby.se, and then there's also another amazing site. It's called Room on Fire TV.
Yes, don't forget to check that out, guys.
That's got all important. The info that you need about Room on Fire, CS schedules, but also a stream that'll be covering everything that's going to happen today.
All right, the players are actually at their computers now, as we can tell. Gera was just sitting in the background before, but this time they look a little bit more focused. And they're on Inferno, so they're on the right map. Can you tell? It looks like there's 5 alternate members on the other team, too. I imagine we're pretty close to being in the game, in fact.
Fiflarin's locking in. He's got the headset on. He's got the headset on. It sounds like we're missing one player here out of the mix, and it seems like somebody was trying to sort out their screen over on alternate. So hopefully that's going to be all right.
You have to get appreciate.
Right. Look how loose he looks right now, man. He just looks amused. Like, okay, this is my Deagle face. You like my Deagle face? Oh no.
You have to appreciate the fact that the NiP logo is on the chairs right there. That's,
well, you know, this is their turf. Yeah. Like, Inferno Online, NiP have a room that's their own, that's in Inferno Online, all with like the NiP chairs, the NiP DX racers, and like branded and everything. So they're on home turf right now, NiP.
And they're feeling it, no doubt, no doubt.
Yeah. It's cool, man. I'm really excited about this. It feels so good now that it's actually happening for DreamHack Stockholm, that we have CS. Because last year around, wasn't happening. Yeah. It was still StarCraft, it was still, you know, everything else, Dota, whatever. But now we've got CS, and it's going to be in Globen as well. That's going to be so amazing. Tomorrow in the Globen Arena.
Yeah.
We're going to have CS on the main stage in front of thousands of people live here in Stockholm.
Quite a statement to send, in fact. And we're still in 2014. It's worth reminding everyone just in the community, because I saw a couple of threads yesterday, I think it was, people discussing, you know, for some reason, people are very interested in ranking, you know, esports. And I think everyone keeps saying, all right, League of Legends on top. That's an easy one, right? And then it comes down to, like, what is, like, second to 10th place? And to me, it really doesn't matter that much. I think that ranking system doesn't really mean anything. But if you want to have that discussion, then please don't rate Counter-Strike before we get to 2015, because that is when the sparks are going to fly.
Wow. Counter-Strike is already clearly second behind LoL.
What about Hearthstone,
sorry,
man?
Sorry, mate.
I mean, you were telling me about Hearthstone and their ridiculous user base yesterday.
About Hearthstone. They've got like 22 million players now. It's insane. Hearthstone is just incredible.
Yeah.
But Hearthstone, nah, they don't rate. Not yet. Maybe we'll give them another year. They'll grow into it. They've got one $250,000 tournament. Yeah, we've got more than that.
We've got more than that. Hopefully even more in the future soon.
Let's see. Go play with the cards.
I've never played Hearthstone. I have no idea what. I don't even really understand it. I have my magic cards at home.
I remember
in the box.
We were eating Let's yesterday. We just threw a Hearthstone stream on to check out, because there's also a DreamHack Hearthstone tournament that's happening right now. So we were looking at that to see, you know, what they were doing with the production. And you were just like, I have no idea what's going on, man.
I really don't. It was Artosis and who else?
Artosis, Frodan, and Savs. Savs, I think is what you say his name.
It's a couple of people, and they were obviously enjoying it very much. And the stream is getting really popular. I just have no idea what's going on. But
it's fun. I mean, it seems like they're doing a really cool job over there. And I think that is a European Cup that's going into the World Championship that's going to happen in November at BlizzCon. So you have the StarCraft II World WCS that's going to wrap up at BlizzCon, and then you also have now the Hearthstone that's going into it. So, I mean, you know, it's getting to that point in the year where all of the Blizzard fans are going to congregate.
Great, considering how well the WCS system has worked out for StarCraft.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. Well, we are hopefully going to be ready soon enough with everything. I'm still very sad that StarCraft isn't doing as well as it should be. I feel like it needs to get some more traction. Such a fun game.
It is. Yeah. It is. It is. It is a fun game to play, except for Swarm Hosts and Broodlords.
Except for Swarm Hosts and Broodlords.
Infinite free units that.
What were
make
the other unit they
sense.
Added at the beginning? Was it like Warhawks? Is it War?
Yeah, wait, no, was it the...
I can't remember.
Yeah, I can't remember.
Called,
the unit that was so ridiculous, they took it out of the game. Like, that is actually, as a developer, that is the last thing. That is the last resort. Like, you're going to throw yourself off a cliff before you have to take something out. And wiggle, wiggle, wiggle. Apparently, I forgot to mute my phone. Apologies.
That's all right. We're still just we're still getting ready. It feels like, you know... They're sort of all warming up, and there is only 4 alternate players on, as far as I can tell. One of them is dead now, so, yeah. 5 NiP members, 4 alternate members, so probably a mouse or a keyboard or a headset or something like that missing out. Maybe it's even the Steam client, that whole can't connect to Steam, whatever it is thing going on. So we do apologize for the delay, but shouldn't be too much longer.
Very cool, very cool. So apparently Globin fits 17,000 during a hockey game. So during a concert event, it's 14,000. So basically, we're going to have 21,000. Does that make sense?
No.
Totally makes sense. Because basically, esports is going to create a pocket in time and space that's going to fit another 4,000 people in there.
I hope we get it filled up. It'd definitely be very cool. I think the effects of having Counter-Strike in front of our live audience is really, really amazing.
Yeah.
We saw this at Katowice, which is one of the reasons why that event was so cool.
Mm-hmm.
At Gamescom, it's a very different feel, because Gamescom is not really meant for spectating, right? Yeah. Gamescom is it's an exhibition show where you go and you show all your products to a bunch of people who want to buy them. And ESL actually very smartly. Yes, for the first couple of days at Gamescom, we only had one stage. And there were a bunch of people outside. So actually on the last day, ESL managed to open up and have sort of a second stage used. So there were more people watching. And it influences the game. You can feel when more people are watching a live audience and they get excited about it.
Oh, it changes everything. Yeah, man.
It is so, so much better.
The energy is totally different. As soon as people are watching like that behind, it makes everything just crazy. And then also, well, the stage like that, Gamescom was, I mean, it was still like a few hundred people who were able to fit in to actually watch, but you know, it wasn't quite the same.
But I think actually the name of the game in the future, if you want to have a really good major tournament, you know, a $250,000 tournament for the future, has to be try and get as many people live in front that can be watching it. Like, The more, the better. I think you're going to have a better event overall.
Well, that's Katowice for you, right? They had something like 12,000 people in the crowd. I mean, that certainly makes a big difference, especially when you were listening. You could actually listen in on the comms for the players, and just every time they talked, their mics would be picking up the crowd, and it's just like this roar that's in the background. Yeah. And you, I mean, that's a totally different experience to, you know, playing right now where they are, at least in Inferno, where, you know, you're still on land, but it's quiet. There aren't too many people there. It's still kind of early on a Thursday afternoon, right? You know, not too much movement. So switching into Globin tomorrow, where there's going to be at least 3,000 to 4,000 people, that's going to be sick. That's going to be a really sick experience.
And we're going to move out because right now we're in the Fragbite studio.
Yeah.
So we're going to be moving out.
You guys
out.
May recognize it.
Exactly. It looks strangely familiar. But we're going to be moving to the Globin as well. And we'll be there. We'll bring Thorin in, which is going to be great. It's been, it feels like it's been far too long since we've been hanging out with Thorin.
Way too long, man. I know. But he's back. He's back in Sweden. And DreamHack, you know, they're cool. Right now, we're still waiting. It looks like maybe we're about to get on there. Robin, got to give a shout-out to Robin as well. Robert behind there, the man holding the paper. He's the head DreamHack admin running this tournament, making sure that everything runs smoothly. So if it's a technical issue, it's probably not his fault, so don't throw him to the wolves. But he's definitely very good at what he does. It seems like right now we're still waiting on that one alternate member to get the thing sorted out. But there's the thumbs up. So
yeah.
All players are in. This is it. We are going to be getting into this momentarily, guys. The first match here for DreamHack Stockholm.
Yeah, this is about time to get it on. We do have a really long schedule ahead of us of all best of one games. So, yeah, if you guys have, you know, haven't already sort of cleared your schedule for the day and for tomorrow, then now's a good time to do is cancel all appointments.
Yeah.
Postpone all homework.
Yeah, take a vacation day if you can't take a sick day.
Exactly. That's how it is.
That's how you roll. Because this is going to be sick. You don't want to miss out Stockholm. And this is, I mean, it's going to be the entire thing in Globin Arena as well. But not only that, I mean, if during the breaks, you know, when the CS isn't up on the stage, you guys can actually go out and check out the vendor area as well. There's like a whole venue. I think they're going to have like some kind of esports panel or something discussion there. I mean, there's going to be a whole bunch of other stuff that's happening on top of the CS. So well worth your time. I mean, if you're in the Stockholm area, if you're close by train, you know, just come on over and check it out.
Yeah, and the metro station is literally right next to the place. So you take the metro to the Globin metro station, which is aptly named.
It's kind of hard to miss Globin because it's just like anywhere in the city, pretty much, you can see it and be like, oh, there, okay, that's where I got to go.
And hopefully the metro is working now, which
it
wasn't.
A big white ball.
It wasn't this morning when I was going to get here. That was the most frustrating thing. I bought my SL card.
You know, you were so proud.
Yeah,
you had your SL card.
Like, I can travel anywhere in Stockholm. I'm so happy. Then I you know, checked it through and went down to the metro. And just when I got there on the speakers, they said, oh, by the way, the train's canceled.
Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, it was the same thing.
Great.
fun times. Sometimes, you know, the thing is, that's definitely one of my favorite things here in Stockholm is that it has such excellent public transport. But that's the funny thing. You're so used to it running flawlessly, perfectly, that when something goes wrong, it's like crisis, panic. You know, what's going on? What's happening? How is this possible? The trains don't work. Sometimes it happens.
I actually haven't had many issues. In Denmark, it's a different experience. Let's put it like that. Well, but they have a smart method
come to Los Angeles.
They have a smart way of dealing with it in Denmark because. Mm-hmm. The way it works in Denmark is if the train isn't on time, the company running the trains gets fined.
Oh.
But, so what they do instead is they just change the schedule all the time, so it's never late. The schedule changes. It's genius. I love it. All right, guys, enough about public transportation and more about Counter-Strike. Welcome to the show. This is NiP versus Team Alternate for DreamHack Stockholm, and it's the first game. Best of one on Inferno. I'm Anders, and with me is Summer, of course, and we're going to be ready. It's going to be all day, so please invite your friends, and let's just enjoy this show.
Yeah, this is going to be some sick CS for the next 2 days. We've got eight of the best teams in the world right now about to compete here in Stockholm, Sweden. And unfortunately, the sunny weather is gone. We're getting into the fall.
Well, actually, I was thinking about this because it is raining outside and it's really dark and gray. It's a perfect time to be inside at the warm glow of the computer monitor in front of you. It's perfect. I feel like if it was sunny outside.
LCD monitor.
Exactly. You know, I feel like it's perfect.
Yeah, no, this is the secret, basically. It's because winter, you get like 3 hours of sunlight a day. So when you've got fiber internet, just stay inside and game. That's why some of the best teams in the world come out of Sweden across all esports.
Yeah, it's scary, isn't it?
I don't know what
how many of them end up on top.
It's just incredible. And now, I mean, property maybe. They were showing some good play over the past few days, qualified for frag bite, played in the Case King last night, put up a good fight. I mean, maybe we have you know, a third team that's going to be able to come out of Sweden and actually start taking it to the big teams.
Why not? If you just list all the current sort of halfway hidden talent that's in Sweden, if you put it all on one list, you could make a lot of teams. You know, just having a little bit of a tech issue, but you know, yeah. So we were talking about Twist yesterday, who has maybe joined a Flipside team. I've heard,
yeah,
maybe. Who else have we got? POVS is one of the guys out there who people forget about him because again, you don't see him in a regular lineup. But you see him as a stand-in every once in a while, and then he just comes in and wrecks and does really well.
So
I think if you took all the hidden talent, as it were, on, you know, that's not currently playing a lineup in Sweden, you could make some really good teams anyway.
Sure. I mean,
it's kind of scary.
It's like it's been like that in Finland. It's been like that in Norway. It's been like that in Sweden. It seems like right now we have two consistent teams that are able to stick together really over the long haul. For a while, we had LGB as well. That was back when Schneider and Doublewalk were still playing for Fnatic, and LGB were still together with Olofmeister Krims and the rest of the crew, Huita and Michaelele. So, I mean, there is some sick talent. Dennis as well. We can't forget Dennis. He's kind of floating around, hasn't really been picked up by a team. So much talent coming out of Sweden, but also, it's like almost rivaling it. France, what's up?
Yeah.
Three teams out of France, and all of them competing on the world stage.
And probably even more that we don't know about. I think we know more about the Swedish scene because we get to see more stand-ins and stuff like that. Yeah, so I think actually if you took a look at, you know, the second-tier teams in France, you'd probably find a lot of talent there as well.
And on Epsilon, we got a glimpse of some of the talent, Mistu, when he played for Epsilon.
Yeah.
He came up from the sub-top to the super-top.
Yep. And just, you know, it's more evidence of the fact that the talent pool isn't just what's in the current top teams. Someone like Simple stepping up and playing for Hellraisers. Not that we've never heard of Simple before he was in Hellraisers, because he's been playing in a bunch of different Ukrainian and Russian teams. But never considered, you know, on that level. Unless you happen to pay really closely attention to those scenes, sort of, you know, locally you were paying attention. Maybe you knew that Simple had some good talent. But otherwise, you'd probably just be thinking, all right, you know, he's not in one of the top teams. He can't be that good.
Well,
and then you see him yesterday, or just, you know, generally playing in the last couple of while here, and he's been absolutely insane.
No, he has. I mean, he's definitely made the impact. It's kind of going back to Epsilon with Foxio. When Foxio joined, having that dedicated opera makes a difference. But it looks like, guys, we're about to go live here and get into our first match. It's going to be on Inferno between NiP and Alternate. Welcome if you're just joining us here. But this is DreamHack Stockholm, and we can see the players playing live from Inferno, one of the biggest lands in Europe. So getting into it, Gob B, it's going to be taking point up here at Top Banana, but Alternate will be starting on the T side, having lost that knife. No surprise that NiP decided to go on the defense and start off with the CT side.
Yeah, no, that's what they want to do, of course. And Alternate getting a little bit of control of apartments here, just trying to see if they can force NiP back. Forest holding close towards quad, and I think this is going to be a really explosive play from Alternate. I think once they peek at Forest here, they're all going to keep going for him. And yeah, they just do run around the corner. Forest playing it smartly, using the angles here to work against the Alternate team. But it's going to be SMN picking up the first kill on Forest. Now down to the pit, Exist is still alive, looking for a return frag on somebody. He's taking a fight with everyone all at once. And Sonix comes jumping down, almost gets a second kill here. The bomb has been planted, but Alternate, they're trapped inside the bomb site.
Freiburg still takes a man with him. That was so important. And Exist is still alive in the pit. It's a one-on-one. Tizian is alive sitting on that bomb plant, and there is a kit he can pick up here somehow. Freiburg, I think, had it for NiP, so Exist is going to just try and rush down Tizian, see if he can get on this fast enough, but he's running out of time, and Tizian lands the headshot. Exist can't quite find the shot after living through everything in the pit. He just couldn't get it done.
Great round from Alternate. I love that play. That was so simple. There was nothing flashy about what they just did. They came out of apartments with one guy. That was Sonix jumping out there. And everyone else ran out by quad. And once they had the engagement, they didn't stop. They didn't give NiP a lot of time to make any rotation. And that worked out.
Yeah, uncharacteristic there, Forrest, actually. He was the point man for NiP. He was backed up by Exist, and NiP really tried to play the hard counter to this, which was have two guys alive in pit. They didn't get smoked off, so if those guys are alive in pit, they're going to be a real thorn in Alternate side. But Forrest is going to be the point man, seeing as how he's on the site, and he wasn't really able to land a shot. If he had picked up one guy there, that could have made the difference for NiP. But Alternate will walk away with the pistol. Aprox dropping down to 12 HP, though. It's not the best start from him. But Fifarn has been spotted out in bedroom, and he's going to get picked off.
Forest having a deagle and Geraint having a scout, which on Inferno is a little bit strange. I think he has already hit one person with it, but so far Alternate doing a decent job of playing the anti-eco, Which is worth mentioning because a lot of teams do fail quite miserably at playing these Antiqua rounds and it costs them dearly. Freiburg goes down, that's all the way over at Banana, and now it's just Forrest and Getright left.
Get right with that scout. He's still looking for a target. You gotta admire Alternate right now, playing so patiently, so safe. They aren't giving any targets they get to work with here. And that's what it's all about at this point. They just want to make sure that they don't give anything away. They don't want to open it up. Forrest is going to have the deke, though. He's going to pick one kill, but God B will find Getright with that scout. And now they know. Alternate not wasting any time at all. They go straight to the B site. They know that that's where Getright plays. Forrest is still somehow finding kills, though.
Yeah, that's a bit of a shame for God B that he got... that he couldn't make it around the corner then.
And Forrest should be able to find a gun. Yeah, he's got the Galil now. So this is nice. This is a nice play here from Forrest, actually. He can consider this a one round as far as he's concerned. Two kills and a gun is pretty good.
Yeah, he's not going to go for exit frags, which can't really blame him for.
No, this is the smart play to make from him. I mean, 1v3 walking into it at half HP, no Kevlar, no nades. It would be an insanely difficult retake for him. But him getting the two parting shots with the Deagle and holding onto a Galil, that's a lot of money. We can see his money just jumps up. He's got 2,800 value on him right now.
Yeah. So the fish aren't going to be surviving this round. I bet Forrest is pretty going to throw that Galil over to a teammate and then keep the Deagle because it makes more sense to spread the weaponry more evenly. So I wouldn't be surprised if that's what we're going to see. A little bit paranoid down there.
Yeah, at this point, we could even see Forrest just go for Kevlar if he wanted to. Maybe not helmet armor, but he could definitely pick up Kevlar and just try and make that Galil work for himself. Drops that Deeg to Freiburg, for example, because Freiburg is a monster with the Deeg. So right now, we have Alternate on your screens. And so far, they're off to a really good start here on Inferno. First map of this tournament, they're already up 2-0 versus NiP. And you're right, Getright will get dropped at FAMAS. Or not the FAMAS, rather, the Galil.
Yeah, it makes a lot more sense to do that. Forrest is going to keep it, but you are right about Freiburg. He's a sick Deagler, so I wouldn't be surprised if that's gonna end up in his hands later on anyway.
Yeah, Freiburg, hard eco for him. Forrest, Deagle. I mean, Exist actually spends another 300 bucks here with the P250, so NiP still feeling comfortable enough to go ahead and invest a little bit of money. But this Galil is going to be great for them if they can just find a target. And so far, it's on the B site. NiP... changing up their positioning as well. Getright is usually playing the position that Freiburg is in right now. Freiburg is usually the guy who falls back over into the new boxes, but this is why. They've actually boosted Getright up here in the corner. This is sick.
Now, did he get boost or did he boost himself?
That's a good question, because Ulfmeister apparently can boost himself up there. But still, yeah. that is just the ninja play right there. They're living up to their names.
It's a good idea, but it rarely ever really pays off, and I guess right now it definitely won't because Alton are making their way towards the A bomb site. The thing is, if they're around Archway, Forrest is actually over there with the Deagle, and that's a really good position. I think he's halfway covered by the statue that's over there, so Forrest could definitely pick up a quick kill. This is still a little bit scary for Alternate, but they're going to go in unless MN goes down. That's Fiflown with the USPS. They will take care of him, but it's another kill coming in from Exist. And right now, they're just trading a lot.
Yeah, that's good enough right now. Great opening frag there by Fiflar, and that's going to start things off strong here for NiP. Getright going to be rotating in through mid. So Tijan is going to be the man who's listening for Getright, essentially. He's going to hear steps by short as well, and that's going to be Freiburg picked up. It's going to be Getright now around this corner, and Tijan, he seems to know. He heard him stepping.
Yeah, he's playing this position really well, Tijan. That's just nice to see. Also, losing a couple of players, but they don't panic. They're just playing a calm game right now. Getright goes down as well, and Forrest is going to be dropped, so no Galil saved either. And that's a third round for Alternate. I'm impressed already. When you're playing a team of this caliber on land, you've got to expect there's going to be a lot of nerves on the Alternate team. But right now, they're not showing it, and that's exactly how they want to do it. They have the AWP right now picked up on a prox, and it's going to be NiP with just pure rifles. No scoped rifles right now.
Yeah, no scoped rifles for them. Just not really willing to crack the money. They'd much rather have the nades, and this is smart play from them, really. Just get the nades, go for the flash. Let's see. He gets control of Banana, because they've actually gone for the smoke at bottom Banana here, NiP. He's got backing from Getright as well. So this is Freiburg basically just taking point here for NiP. But Alternate, they know exactly how to counter this play. They're just going to go ahead and look to get control of apartments at this point.
The king of Banana, right?
The king of Banana is here. And I mean, we have to see. Freiburg, it feels like it's been a long time since we've seen him with those dominant streaks in Banana. But then at the same time, it's just teams are getting so good at holding these positions now that Freiburg can't just walk in and have his way with them. He has to actually earn it these days.
He does. A very slow round coming out here from the German team. Taking it, very relaxed. Just waiting for NiP to make a mistake and peek somewhere. But right now, they're not. You can see that the CT side is really defensive.
Wow.
Oh my god, that's a sick opening from SMN. But Freiburg with a double return going for a third one. Getright's going to be there to help out with that one.
And now it is going to be a 2-on-3. It's still not lost for alternate, but they need this next kill to go in their favor, and it's not going to happen. Get right. We'll take down a prox, and now it's SMN left. On four, that opening should have been alternate's spark.
Yeah, and it seems like they wanted to try and perhaps, you know, speed up everywhere across the map after SMN got that frag. See if they can't catch Nip off guard, but Freiburg and Getright playing it magnificently in that position. Freiburg in particular with the double spray down, Getright helping out as well. Four kills between the two of them over on Banana is just excellent. But Forrest is now going to be the point of contention here. He's going to spot him out. 10 seconds left. Forrest putting shots in, and he doesn't get the kill. There's actually only going to be barely enough time here to get this bomb plant down, but he comes off of it.
Yeah, that is a real shame for SMN, because he could have kept it down and got his team the $800 bonus then. And even if he had killed Forrest, he would have still lost a round. So I'm not sure that was really worth it. That opening, though, from SMN is still... That was a really nice pre-fire. He saw in his mind's eye that Fiflaren was going to be right there. And alternate already unable to buy here. And if we bring up the scoreboard real quick, I'm wondering... Oh, flashed. Yeah, so the $800 bonus would have made a difference. They could have actually probably been able to force it up if they had got that bonus.
Yeah, exactly. That money makes a big difference when it comes down to it, because that's a set of nades right there if you can afford the Galil. Ooh, Aprox with a great headshot, and they're going to catch Get right before he can get around the corner, but Exist is now here to plug the gap, and he's going to do a magnificent job of it. Double spray for him, and it's down to Tizhen, but Tizhen has now got an M4 to play with. He's going to back off and play this smart. He's got the bomb, and he's now got a rifle.
Yeah, he's also trapped in here, so he's going to have to try and kill Fiflaren, and that won't happen. Swedish player just sticking to it and having a good angle. So second round for NiP. Now alternate can buy him, you know, plant or no plant. They're going to be able to do it here. And they do have enough for an AWP if they wanted it. TCN could have dropped one for a prox, but they're going to go all AKs. And I think that's a reasonable choice.
Yeah, faster play. They're going to be more mobile like this. They don't have to rely on that AWP to get an entry frag for them, perhaps. So they want to be able to just speed up behind anything that open that shows itself pretty much alternate. If they can get a frag... They're going to want to put pressure. God B is actually going to get naded and mollied down. So again, that nade pressure coming out here from NiP. They're really not willing to give alternate this the control of Banana in the early game. They want to get control of this part of the map so that they can start setting up on the other side.
Yeah. NiP, they succeed in doing it. Alternate were trying to fight for it initially, but it's kind of no point when all those grenades are raining in. Now instead, they're going to go for some control in the apartments, which is... You know, you got to have something somewhere, right?
Yeah.
Either Banana or Apartments. Just going straight up middle without controlling anything else is a little bit of a risk, unless you make it a rush.
And this is crazy control coming out here from NiP as well. They're just willing to play so passively back up onto the site, about as far back as you can get. There's the molly that's going to wake SMN up, and that actually buys a lot of time. Four players here for NiP. Smoke goes down, and it's going to be Forrest actually peeking forward on short, and this is a risk. He could get punished, but he does get the parting headshot on SMN.
Now they've got everyone in this bomb site. I'm not sure what alternate needs to do. I think maybe just keep a couple of people here and see if NiP are going to re-peek them and then go back to B. That seems like a slightly better choice. Yeah, and they do leave one guy, so that's really important here. Sonics, though, I think he has to be a little bit more offensive than he is. He's still playing it too defensively. Now he's actually walking all the way back, so I think this is going to be really hard now for alternate.
Good rotation there from NiP. They're going to manage to get one guy over here. That's going to be Getright in construction. He's going to try and cut up this site with Freiburg. As soon as they cross this line, Getright's going to be here. And there you go. Shoots one in the back. 10 seconds left. If they can stop the bomb plant, it's perfect. And Freiburg with the double spray. Double headshot. And alternate will lose this round. They've run out of time. Zonix. Oh, no. They just barely get the bomb plant in time.
They did get the bomb down. But
That was a split-second deal. I thought that they had managed to cancel that.
Yeah, it looked like it, because there was grenade training in as well, but nope, they do manage to do it.
So dramatic zoom in on Exist, calling out the shots.
I'm wondering how that could have worked out differently. I still think if alternate had kept one guy over at A, if nothing else, try and pick off the people that were going to rotate from A to B. Mm. Just, I don't know, having everyone at B, especially because the way Sonic's played it, he was just kind of far behind, and he wasn't really fulfilling much of a role the way he was standing, so a little bit of a shame.
No. Alternate not having enough money to buy up this round. They're just going to go for this straight CZ-75. McFarlane gets mowed down when he's faced by three pistols, and this is going to be brutal. Freiburg has picked off the box on the other side. Good play there by Forrest. Despite being flashed, he's managing to hold this position, and the bomb gets dropped right in front of him like a party favor. Last man alive is going to be Zonix, and he's on the site, manages to take Exist with him. So actually, all in all, not too bad a Nico round here coming out from Team Alternate. They do manage to get two kills. So anything they can do right now to keep NiP's money in check is going to be considered a win for Alternate, because we do actually have three of them starting to get pretty decent banks. Four of them still, although Exist is yet to buy. Exist is going to buy here. That's going to drop him down a little bit lower. Right now, you have to admire the control that NiP are going for here in Banana. They're really not willing to give it up too early to alternate. Nades go down, and Gobbia once again getting dropped so low, and he's going to burn to death.
Oh,
big mistake there.
Yeah, that's not a fun way to start around. Flash goes in, Aprox almost getting peeked there by Get Right, but he's still going to be moving forward. Now they do need a return frag, and preferably a little bit fast.
Oh, look at this, though. This man really trying to cause a diversion over there, but Get Right gets flashed in. Not going to stick around to take that shot. It's going to be Freiburg to pick up the kill. And that tag team duo over on the B site right now, NiP, are playing that marvelously. Alternate really struggling to land the shots when they need to. SMN, however, he's been doing so well for Alternate throughout the beginning of this half. Gets picked off by Forrest as he's peeking around through apartments. And it's going to be Tizhen alive in a 1v5 coming up on quad. Forrest is waiting right around the corner. It's actually going to be Forrest and Exist peeking at the same time. So good clean kill there.
All right, so that round was a really bad one for Alternate. Of course, they didn't kill a single member of NiP, so now the Swedes have way more money to work with. And the problem here is that up until this point, it felt like Alternate had a chance of getting through if they could just land, you know, one more opening kill. That would have been enough here. But when you play around like that, it's got to bring you down a fair bit. And this time, they don't go for the aggression over a banana. Alternate taking it slowly. They don't want to run into any kind of issues here. And LIP, on the other hand, are also playing extremely defensively.
Yeah, both teams, in fact, really changing up the pace here. So NiP trying to keep Alternate on their toes. They don't want to become too predictable, chucking nades down every time so that Alternate can expect those nades. NiP decide to play it passive one round, and they're playing passive all over the place. Although, one thing that's different, because NiP don't actually put the smoke down at bottom banana and fight to get control of banana, Forrest did start out in apartments there to see if he could pick anybody up from Alternate. But again, they're going to fall right back down to passive positions, and Alternate are going to be able to get some good control of the map.
And for the kind of setup that they're running right here, there is actually an opening for a pretty cool B-split push if they manage to smoke off towards library and then split B. But Alternate can't really know that right now. If they keep pushing like this, they might get the information that that's going on. God, B's going to flash himself through the smoke, and are they going to be able to find anyone? It's Exist around the corner. A lot of grenades raining in here, and it's a great headshot from God B. Going for a second one. He spots a guy down in pit. That's great information, and that's going to be the Forest going down. SMN will pick up that one, and if Flowering falls next, a perfect take for Alternate. That was a beautiful round, and Get Right, there's nothing he can do. Get some exit kills, maybe, but winning the round is not an option any longer.
Oh, he just barely misses out on the shot on Aprox. He's going to have an AK now, but they know exactly where he is, Alternate. One thing for Alternate, I mean, it would be good to be able to get this rifle off of NiP, off of Get Right, but NiP have plenty of money to buy up in the next round, whereas Alternate are strapped for cash. They're going to reset everything here. They're going to get just win bonus money at this point, but they can't really afford to be giving up rifles right now.
Now, the one weakness that I was talking about, which is why I said a B-split push could have been a thing, was because Exist was holding so far back towards library instead of further up towards archway. So the reason why this works out for them anyways, because when they throw those flashes, instead of Exist being able to actually take the fight with them, he gets forced even further back. And eventually, NiP, instead of really defending the bombsite, they get locked inside the bombsite. And Alternate, they come in from all angles. The only guy that could have stopped that from happening, except for, you know, Exist staying alive longer than he did, was the guy down in pit. Pit guy can defend that bombsite for a while, but the people inside the bombsite have a really hard time of doing it.
It was nicely done by SMN getting out on balcony so fast. As soon as God B was putting pressure over on long, SMN picks off Forrest from balcony in that pit. So NiP just kind of got picked apart there really quickly. Freiburg rotating around through Arch got nailed instantly as well by Aprox. So it really did just look very clean there for Alternate. That's what they're aiming for here. They're up on four rounds now. They just need a couple more in this half to really start feeling comfortable. So if they can pick up another one, NiP are going to be starting to feel a little bit of the hurt as far as their economy is concerned. So opportunity here for Alternate to really turn the tide.
Okay, right. Flashing himself through. He's still blind, but he's still picking up that kill on TC. That's got to be annoying for Alternate. And right now, NiP have a very good setup to deal with what's coming here. Backup is coming forced with the AWP, and there's a guy down in pit still, so this is not looking too bad for the Swedish team.
Well, Get Right lives with 15 HP. SMN, they know he's on short now. And Get Right's actually jumped up on the box to get an angle into apartments, but is it going to be Zonix? Is Zonix going to spot him? And yes, Zonix does. He gets tagged first, but he does manage to pick up that kill on Get Right, so back to a 4-on-4 situation, and this favors Alternate.
But the time, 30 seconds, is not a lot here. If Flaren's going to take down SMN, they got to commit to something, and it's going to be the B push. They're leaving, again, one guy behind, which I think is a good idea, but this revolves all of it right now on Freiburg not going down quick here for NiP, and he's going to peek them out already, so they know what's coming. 15 seconds left. Aprox goes down. Gob B wanting to get up here, kill Freiburg and put the bomb down, and it doesn't happen.
Not meant to be. Forrest is already in position to stop Zonix from coming around that corner as well. Easy shot for him. And Nip just bouncing right back in this situation. We see how focused Alternate are right now as well.
So. Yeah. A little bit of frustration, I think.
No, they might be, they might be. I mean, this is still very clear.
You can't blame them either, because as it is right now, NiP has been winning. I mean, we're in the 11th round here, and they've been winning almost 6 rounds in a row. There's the one round where Alternate took it, so 5 rounds in a row for NiP, and then they're back on track. And Alternate are in a bit of a tight situation spot right here, because if they lose this upcoming round, they're going to be ecoing, no doubt.
Yeah, that's the thing. Right now, they've probably spent every dime they've got. And actually, if we can bring up the scoreboard very rapidly here to take a look at the money. Yeah. So, Alternate, not much money, and still good bank on NiP. That's the real problem here, is that Alternate... Okay, we can take down the scoreboard. But, like, now that Alternate are just not able to close out those chain rounds versus NiP, it's not going to be easy for them to get those easy eco rounds versus NiP. Because NiP are always going to have bank to be able to actually buy up or force. And that's how Alternate really run away with this first half. If they get NiP to eco, it changes everything.
They're already not doing a bad job, Alternate. If they string one more round here, I think you're right. That eco round for NiP, that's what they're gunning for here. Forrest legging already one, and there's some great grenades raining in. Look how low they all are right now. And if they come... Oh, that's nice. Exist goes down. Fiflaren with a return grenade, though. So it's still going to keep Alternate in a bit of an odd position here. SMN goes down to get right. He saw it coming, but he still couldn't land the shot. Now Gob B is right at the edge, and get right will pick up a second kill, leaving Aprox and Sonix here. 2-on-4, and... The defense is just a little bit too tight this round.
Fiflaren doing a fantastic job. Force with that AWP rotates in, but Fiflaren with two frags, one of them a nade and one of them a very clean kill on short. That's going to set things up perfectly for NiP, and they only lose one gun on Exist, and that's about as good as it gets right now for NiP. If they can maintain just losing one guy like this per round, look at where their money is. It's obscene. This is very difficult. Now, they're in a position, or they're getting very close to a position where they won't have to worry about money for the rest of the half. Whereas Alternate, they're forced to eco, and this is just not going to help their situation. Now, coming out of this, NiP should have just mountains of cash, and this should be pretty easy for them to focus on just playing their game without having to worry about the money.
So, I think Alternate going for a bit of a... Oh, they were. He drops the bomb over there. I kind of wish they were trying to fake it then, because they were all at B, and then SMN with the bomb over here, but obviously we can see they switched up entirely. It would have been cool if they would tried to force NiP to rotate and then just jump into A and put the bomb down or something like that.
Yeah. NiP. Yeah, that's definitely an option. NiP, however, are one of those teams that are just very good at the basics, and one of the basics is don't rotate off the site unless you see the bomb. Once you have the bomb, then you know, okay, the bomb is over on the B site, I go off of A. But until you see that, NiP are very good about not falling for fakes, or at least always leaving one guy behind on a site.
SMN's picked up a rifle, but Getright's going to take it away from him again. No issue at all. Prox and Sonix left here. They've only got the one kill and exist, which is maybe not quite enough for this round.
Oh, Fiflaren. Sonic's doing great damage, but Fiflaren will come out ahead in the end. Two frags for Fiflaren in this anti-eco, and again, it's only Exist. He still gets two kills as a parting gift, but Exist is not really lucky right now. He seems to be the one who always gets caught. But NiP still sitting on good stacks of cash. Two rounds left in this half. Or three rounds, rather. But
we're sort of approaching the very end of the first half here, and Alternate need definitely more than 4 rounds. I think they need to get 6 and even better 7, and that could happen if they start stringing rounds together, but I think 6 rounds has to be the goal here for Alternate. Forrest. Don't think 5 is enough either.
Forrest, this position from Forrest could be crucial. They're up in apartments right now, and I don't think they have any idea that Forrest is behind them. Don't think Forrest was able to see them go by in the smoke either. He could have a great flank position here if only he was able to go out and take a peek. But they're going to come out through boiler first. Fiflaren with the double spray down, controlling short, doing exactly what he has to do. And Forrest is going to be into the rescue. Picks off Gob B. It's going to leave Aprox alone over at Arch for Get Right to pick up. And that was about as good as it gets there. Fiflaren with the double kill, really putting a stop to Team Alternate's push.
Oh, man. And then the initial headshot through the smoke over on Banana as well. Just a lot of things working out great for NiP here. And obviously, if you flare him with that double, that killed everything.
And Exist then decides to go for the SCAR 20. And this is one of his pocket... not his pocket strats, but it's definitely one of his plays that he likes to do because he is very good with the SCAR 20 on this map in particular. It's the only map that he'll pick up the gun on. So when Exist goes for the SCAR 20 on Inferno, you know they're feeling pretty comfortable.
Why wouldn't they? They're about to get a 10th round here as the auto sniper just basically saws the alternate members to bits here. And Forrest up in the apartment's going to take down TZN as well. It will be 10-4 here. alternate. The best they can do is another round at the end, and hopefully they'll have some money to make it work.
Yeah. Flash, Forest. I mean, right now you're right. You know, they just need to have money to buy. If they can get that fifth round in this half, that would be maybe enough for alternate to get things going for themselves. If they were to pick up the pistol in the second half, they would be able to probably run it back and get into a tie situation. But it's all on this last round here for alternate. And we haven't really seen them put any kind of aggression towards Banana. They've really been getting, not predictable, but showing that they really want to get control of apartments, get up into mid-second mid. They've been focusing on that part of the map. So I'm curious if alternate now are going to try and change it up and maybe put some early aggression on Banana just to try and rattle NiP a little bit. But it doesn't look like it. They're deciding to just play very passive right now and wait out the nades.
Yeah, they're not feeling it at all. And then IP going for their grenade routine just to try and clear anyone out. In fact, they're putting three people up there. So if alternate had been doing that, it might not have ended too well anyway. Forest checking second mid, not finding anyone, but he will find God B down there, and it's going to be annoying. And the smoke is going to allow him a clean entrance back to the A bomb site. So it's all planned out in Forest's mind there.
Yeah, then it all works out perfectly, right? Kefaran taking a peek down mid, drops Tijan down to half HP, or half five, rather. Molly could be brutal. It's going to be Forest actually going for a peek, and SMN is going to pick him up. So now the question is, where do they decide to go from this situation? It's a 4-on-4 now. Alternate now have a way to get onto the site. Three members here for NiP still. They still have some good nades on Alternate as well. They could try and smoke off pit and just try and work their way in.
Well, opening kill here for GetRight onto SMN. Exist can't see a thing, and he's not going to pick up the kill currently. Prox will take down GetRight, and now we're getting into a close situation here. Alternate, a lot riding on this round for them. They're going to take down FiFlyer and Sonics with a headshot and Exist as well. Now Freiburg in a 1-on-3. Great play here from the German team. That's exactly what they needed. Five rounds. If they win the pistol, maybe it's enough. I think it's going to be tough, but still a lot better than four. Freiburg looking for the clutch here, but how is he going to do it? He's got no grenades right now. He's got the kit and an AK, and they know exactly where he's coming from. I don't see this happening. Even for Freiburg, this is a bit of a stretch. He's going to go down to Sonics, and Alternate will pick up the fifth round. Very nicely played. Got to say, I am impressed by how well Alternate was playing here.
I agree.
10-5 for a first half is actually, against NiP on Inferno, that's very good.
It's solid work. It's definitely solid work. So, 10-5, yeah, okay. We're going to get to it now. There's been a bit of a commotion, but 10-5 is definitely the place to be right now for Alternate, especially after having lost so many rounds in the half. Towards the end there, you know, they got off to a strong start, but then they were never really able to chain anything together against NiP. So picking up that fifth round now puts it within workable distance. Like, now they can actually get something done in the second half. 11-4 would have been a very, very tight game for Alternate, but now Pistol goes in, and Tijan gets spotted out at mid. Just a short exchange of shots, and not too much damage dealt.
Well, welcome to the show if you're just joining us. It's the second half here. Best of one on Inferno, Alternate and NiP for DreamHack Stockholm. And already, SMN with a great opening double headshot right here. Exist going to charge in, burst fire being used as well. Get right in for Flaren, get the kill, but Sonics is going to take down for Flaren, looking for another headshot. Not quite going to happen, but he does drop Exist very low, and Aprox, they're both stuck down in the pit. This is a horrible position for NiP.
Actually, this is a bit of a problem. Yeah, they go for the smoke as well. They're just saying, okay, you're not getting out of that pit. There's still a minute left, though, so NiP have some options, and look at this. They're going to try and go for the boost. Does Forrest get up here fast enough? He's looking for the angle. Doesn't spot anybody holding the angle there. Frox, he now knows that Forrest is up high, but they're really trying to change things up here.
How are they going to get it? I mean, eventually the smoke's going to get away soon. And actually, Forrest is going to use the smoke to pick up the bomb instead. So that's kind of clever.
Oh, look at that! Forrest, Exist sneaks his way out. He uses the smoke and gets out to the site. And Forrest just chucks him the bomb. Forrest is still playing from pit. Lands the headshot on God B. Aprox now in a 1v2. The tables have turned.
Yeah, it's going to be a really tough clutch once again. Prox coming in looking for the kill on somebody. Exist would be the best target, but right now the bomb is planted so great for NiP. Going to be one grenade down. He's looking already, not finding anyone. Exist is far away. He's not going to get picked off at all. Like, Prox is going to have to find him here. And Forrest running up. Prox doesn't get the kill. It's Forrest instead. And NiP do come out on top of that 2-on-2. And that's pretty great. That is not an easy position to fight your way out of.
That's incredible that they managed to sneak their way out there. Exist, when he jumped up on the truck like that, I'm like, they're going to check. He's going to get caught there because it does take you quite a bit of time to actually get out from that position. It's a very slow creeping crawl. But then Forrest uses the smoke, picks up the bomb, and then manages to just lob it over to Exist onto that site. That was marvelous play from NiP.
Oh, and very creative. Very sad for Alternate because they were so close to having their round. SMN with that double headshot. it felt like they were just about to do it, and that could have been a really great way for them to get back in now. SMN again, more headshots raining in. He's playing really well today.
Yeah, he is. He certainly is. He's making the difference right now for Alternate in his play in apartments on this T side, and now managing to get two kills in that pistol round, but now starting off strong in this one as well with that P250. Looks like he wants to take another peek. He could potentially find somebody here. He does manage to dink exist, but it's not going to be enough to get the job done. He's going to get taken out.
It's another two deagles on Alternate. I'm a big fan of this.
What is it, like the Danish deegs?
Yeah, more deagles.
More deagles everywhere, man. Just ask for us.
One of them is actually in the graveyard. I think that's Tizian holding over there by the A-bomb site. And mm-hmm. Sonics has one at Archway as well, so this could be pretty cool.
Sonics. Waiting around the angle. Getright's going to go for the nade. Just nades noob corner, make sure that nobody's going to be hanging around there. Sonics gives away his position, and it's Freeburg, the master of banana, the king. And he gets taken out by Aprox. Not expecting that one. They're going to defend this to Galil, but he's not even interested. Aprox, he might as well have a rifle. He's got a CZ.
And I peer a man down. If they lose one more here, that could be terrible. And Exist is very low on health. They're going to be walking into the B-bomb site here. There's only 15 seconds left. The Swedes, they're going to have to move quick. They are having one guy wrap around. That's Getright coming up from behind. But Aprox picks up a second kill and Exist here. And almost gets Forrest killed. So now 6 seconds left. Got B over by Flowers. It's a 2-1-3. The bomb is down.
Yeah, this anti-eco is really rough here for Nip. There's going to be three guys closing in on them. Rifles picked up now as well. Zonix, he's got full Kevlar helmet. He could really put up a fight here. Getright's going to have to land a sick headshot on him to shut him down. Double AK play here for Nip, and there you go. Forced to Getright. Instant frags, and they just walk into the blender. Nip playing those positions down to perfection.
Oh, man. I feel like Alternate are being treated, well, not unfairly, but I think if, you know, whenever somebody looks back in history and looks at this match and, you know, says, how did NiP, how did Alternate do here? Mm-hmm. They're going to look at the score and they're going to see 12-5, and it's much closer than that right now. Alternate are actually playing really good Counter-Strike. They're all the time just a few frags away from taking not just a few more rounds, but a lot more rounds.
Yeah, that's what's making the difference right here. A couple frags here and there. If SMN picks off Exist at the beginning of that round rather than getting picked off in turn,
I mean,
that changes everything, right? So it's very close margins here, but that's what CS is about. It's always close margins. NiP right now, however, are just calmly walking their way through this much weaker eco round here from Alternate. No armor picked up for Alternate. Just a P250 on Zonix right now. They're not going to want to spend too much money because they're trying to save everything they can pretty much in going into the 19th round, which is going to be Alternate's first buy round here. But NiP are casually going to walk up onto this B site and get a bomb plant. So not a whole lot that Alternate can do apart from get into positions for exit frags.
Yeah, so good scouting mission going on there. Exist didn't really have anything to lose, like apart from body armor, so he just walks into the B-bomb site, checks, sees there's nobody there, and then he calls for the backup to arrive with the bomb. So that's smart.
No, it's really clever. Now if Forrest get right, just kind of cleaning house. It's not going to be a whole lot here. Alternate is going to get caught out in apartments, and that's going to be 13 rounds here for NiP. 3 rounds away from securing their first match and putting themselves into the winner match of Group A. 8 teams competing in 2 groups.
And it's Forrest and Getright top fragging right now, as it should be, right?
Well, NiP, right? That's actually...
It's been a while.
Yeah, that's what we want to be seeing here. That's going to relieve a lot of the NiP fans out there because, you know, Forrest and Getright have been a little wonky lately, but it seems like Getright winning Gamescom, maybe that's what he needed. Maybe that's exactly what he needed to feel confident in his game again and start carrying hard because right now, yeah, he's got 20 frags up there with Forrest, and those are the 2 point guys that you're looking at for NiP to really be sitting at the top of the scoreboard. That's how things are supposed to be for the team. You always know that if you're far on his top ranking for NiP, there's a problem.
His own statement as well.
His own statement, exactly. He said that. I mean, he's capable, but if he's up there on the scoreboard...
It means somebody else isn't doing what they should be doing.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's pretty much what it is. Sonics all the way up at the apartments here, and Alternate have rifles. They're very, very far behind. But they haven't lost the game yet. There's still a chance they could come back into it, but they need to win a lot of consecutive rounds here. Need to have a rock-solid defense on the second half.
Yeah, and I like to see this Freeburg again. And for a while, NiP were deciding to put 2 guys up in Banana, having Exist pair up with Freeburg to try and take over Banana. But it looks like Freeburg is content to be the master again, the king. There's only space enough for 1 person on that throne, Anders. And it's Freeburg's throne. So he's taking it back right now, and he's actually just going to be the man trying to ferret out any kind of weakness here in Alternate. But it's going to be a quick play up short here for NiP. They've got 20 seconds left as well. Not a whole lot of time. They need to land some good shots, and Force is going to start off strong, picking off SMN.
and tries to bunny jump through. It's actually kind of fun. Now it's just Sonic's the only one left at the A bomb side. He can't really do anything. He can try and stay alive, but wow. Forrest will take him down. It's a good headshot down in pit. And
I'd love to get an overview of the A site right there, because those smokes were a thing of beauty. They were just cutting up that site completely from the pit. You couldn't see anything at all. You couldn't see short to sight. It was just a wall of smoke. So there really isn't a whole lot that he could do in that position right there. And I do like that Nipper out and hunting these guns. They don't want to let Alternate try and hold on to these. It's going to be a crossfire setup here for Alternate, and God B is going to get the kill on Fifth Lauren. But everybody else is closing in for Nip right now. They're coming in through CT. Aprox holding on the other side of this truck. He's going to manage to pick up Freeberg. Exist will get the kill. And is it just going to be God B holding onto his gun here? And it will.
That's all they have left. 14 to 5. Two more rounds for NiP. And they walk away with the first victory here at DreamHack.com. Mm-hmm. The first match being played right now. It seems like it's going to happen, but...
Are they not going for a force?
No. They're fighting potentially for overtime.
They're fighting for overtime. Interesting. Okay. Alternate, they're willing to take this fight. They're saying, we're going to play perfect from here on out and take 10 rounds in a row versus the major champion team. This is going to be very, very tough here for Alternate. SMN has already picked off one guy, so they've managed to find an opening into a site. Aprox is going to get overwhelmed on the B site, and that's the defense crumbling here. Alternate, they're gonna lose total control.
The thing that I kind of regret about what they're doing here is that they've actually been playing really well with the pistols, so sort of feel like maybe pistol armor wouldn't have been such a bad choice anyway. But
the CZs,
yeah,
they came very close. So there you go, headshot from Tizian instantly picks up Freiberg, or rather, exists. Freiberg is gonna find him. But I mean, you're right. I mean, they have come very close with those CZs, and I mean, just with the pistols in general, you go pistol armor nade and put some good pressure out there. I mean, look at this. Zonix is lighting him up. We're into a 2-on-2.
Some beautiful deagle shots. He almost gets the second one there through the smoke. Does tag get right down to 53? Gob saving his AK like he should.
Yeah.
But it's gonna be 15-5 here. Match and map point for NiP. I don't know. I feel like Alternate, if they go back and look at this whole VOD of this match, they're going to be really upset about how close they actually were. Maybe not to winning it. I don't think it's fair to say that Alternate were in range where they could really win the match a lot, but they could have made this much closer.
They certainly could have. And towards the beginning, especially in the T side, right? NiP winning those two rounds after their first buy, I think that was kind of where all of a sudden Alternate started to struggle. And it turned around. They were able to pick up the pistol round and pick up the following rounds. And Alternate, since that point of NiP being able to buy up and shut them down with rifles, it's really been a touch and go since then. So they're definitely going to have some things to study here. But SMN starting off with a kill on Fafarin is certainly going to be a good start in this crucial round. From this point forward, Alternate have to win 10 rounds in a row.
That's a really effective grenade landing on Freiburg assist down there. So yeah, that's a good start for Alternate. Maybe the 10-round dream is somehow still alive out there.
Is it real?
I don't know. I'm not a big believer in it right now. I don't think Alternate are going to be able to do this. I'd be stunned if they are able to pull through right now.
That would certainly be... I mean, last night was a night of 12-3 comebacks, but if they can manage to do 10 rounds in a row versus NiP, this would be a thing of beauty. This would be going down in the history books, no doubt about it. Let's see how NiP decide to evolve this game, because right now they know that SMN is low. They've tagged up a couple of guys as well. So the man advantage, it's there for Alternate, but just barely. It still makes all the difference that he's alive, however. So NiP are still facing a full roster here, a full lineup for Alternate. And it's going to be Getright kind of lurking about. Smoke goes down to block off Library. He could try and work his way into Arch. He spots out God B, goes for the Mad Spray. Is he going to find a target, however? No, he is not. The rotation is already coming out here from Alternate. It looks like that's all the information God B needed to start getting into a position to help his mate over here on B.
Yeah, Prox all the way back to site. Maybe they can do this. Gob is very close. If only they could get flashed in somehow. Tizian goes down. This smoke is going to prevent him from seeing anything. He's going to be walking casually through. This is a big risk. He reveals himself. He's still going to pick up the one. The second kill. And Gob B saves Alternate in this round. No bomb plant happening right now. And Getright is going to be the only one surviving. Oh, and he goes down after the timer's run out. So he's going to lose a lot of money from that.
That's going to hurt.
That walk through the smoke, that is such a big risk, but he did it just perfectly.
Yeah, and you got to admire that he actually walked through. So they had no idea. Look at this. Exist caught completely unawares. Freiberg, easy kill there. Gobby played that down to perfection, no doubt about it. And for it to work that way, NiP, you know, yeah, I'm sure they were expecting at least either a flash or a step to give away Gobby if he's going to try and rush through smoke like that. But Gobby, nerves of steel. Now it's going to be alternate, you know, playing well so far. They're going for a bit of a NiP style as well. Although they do take over Banana and they're willing to peek. This is the difference here on their CT side. They are still willing to peek in apartments. So they're not playing full passive over on the A side while B side is, you know, being controlled here by from Banana. They're willing to still peek over on the A side as well, which is potentially a little bit dangerous, seeing as how you can assume that NiP are going to be heavily gathered over around in apartments and mid. So if there is a pick for NiP on this side of the map, it could get out of control fast.
Both Aprox and Sonix have taken a fair bit of damage already, which is a problem. And NiP are still playing this really slowly. They're setting up in second mid. I'm wondering if they're going to go for some grenades over. You can see Forest right now. I think is it Forest or Fiflaren? Someone's setting up in second mid right now. Mm-hmm. I think it's Fiflaren right now, ready with the smoke.
Yeah, they're gonna be able to just cover this site. And I'm wondering if they're going to go for the same smokes that we saw in that last round. Okay,
yeah.
Smokes down, balcony everywhere, just covered. They don't want the defense to be able to see anything here.
Yeah, SMN doesn't really care about it. He's just going to be taking down two people with the M4. SMN's been having such a great game already here, but it might not be enough. It's still a 2-on-4. The bomb is not going to go down, and that's Sonix picking up that one. Geraint in a 1-on-3 with 10 seconds left. He's going to make it a 1-on-2, and he's finally going to fall down to Tizian. So another successful defense coming out here for Molten, in spite of NiP trying for that smoke play over by Pit.
Yeah, and do they go for it? There was that gap there, and SMN continues to impress. It's going to be SMN in this position. This gap in the smoke right here allows him to do all the work. He gets two kills again. He's been so effective on that position for alternate as well throughout all of these rounds. So his teammates really being able to lock down the site with his help, and it's going to be just a straight buy here. I like this play here from NiP because Getright, he had a lot more money than his teammates. So it's not the end of the world if he spends 3,700 here, gets an AK, gets armor, and just tries to do something with it.
But I actually think the mistake was with NiP in that last round, because you're right, there was a gap in the smoke for SMN, and that's how it should be. The whole point is that those smokes are only for Pit, they're not for inside the bomb site, which means that the rest of the NiP members should have been coming out of apartments in the meantime, and that would have left it really hard for SMN to do what he did, because he would have had to focus between quad or apartments, and that's really hard. His teammate in Pit probably can't help him all that much.
Well, they had a smoke that went down on balcony as well. So what they would have had to have done is jump into or jump straight into Pit and just try and catch Sonix off guard like that.
Yeah, jump out towards the bomb site from apartments, just out of the smoke. It helps a lot having that smoke to get out of apartments.
Sure, sure.
I think NiP were a little bit too confident in just taking the fight with SMN, and he shut them down. So they could have played it smartly, I think, a little bit smarter than that.
All right, let's see how things go here. Aprox closed in on. Bit scary there. Existence got the Deagle as well. Tizian is looking to try and flank these guys in. NiP, they want to die basically before this clock runs out. This is an eco round from them. It would be catastrophic if they weren't able to get killed. So there we go. Alternate do them a favor. They're going to get picked off, and NiP are going to have ample money to go for a healthy buy.
It's great. I mean, it's good to see that there's nobody right now on the alternate team that's underperforming in terms of kill. Nobody is just completely given up and is out of the game or anything like that. Mm-hmm. They're sticking in here. They need to win another 7 rounds in a row to try and force the overtime, which would be a huge achievement. But I don't know. In my opinion, also have already shown that they've been preparing for this event. They've definitely not just shown up and as like a second tier team and feel like, oh, we'll give it our best shot. I think they came here to win. SMN with a good headshot on Fiflaren, and Tizian's going to take down Forest, but the kill is returned swiftly by Exist.
Swiftly indeed, but there's still the man advantage here on alternate, so they do come out ahead in that exchange. They're trying to find somebody trying to peek about on short, and it's going to be Getright just leading the charge. And now he's got an M4 to play with as well, so he's going to be pleased about that pickup.
Geraint going back to set up a smoke, and great flashbang here, but SMN still goes down. I think that was a bit of a mistake there. Probably should have been able to get up that kill. Now it's just one guy down in the pit trying to hold alive, and I think it's Sonix holding in the pit. Great flashbang again, and that's going to be the kill on Freiburg. 50 seconds left here. The bomb is dropped, and they're going to go and pick it up again. Sonix has to stay alive, and Exist will pick up a second. That's a third kill for the Swedish captain, and the bomb gets planted here. It's Aprox and Gobby trying to retake the bomb side.
Yeah. Oh, they're looking towards Pit, but then the infamous smoke is going to go down, and now life gets very difficult here for alternate. Rushing through that smoke, it's a death sentence, and they realize that. They're going to try and double up on short. So smart play here from alternate, deciding to go together if they can. And yeah, God B, he calls his mate over. He gets spotted out from Pit, however, and Exist is still waiting. But if Exist were to peek at short right now, this could be big. He stops Aprox from getting up onto the site. That's Getright finding that kill, and Exist will get picked up. It's all down to Getright now. God B, he finds the shot, and he finds the kill, just rushes in, but there's no time.
Yeah, that is so sad. And the initial shots they put through that box could have definitely gone through, but NiP win it 16-8. So, as expected, I would say NiP come out with a victory. But I think Alternate, they showed a lot more than I was expecting here.
Yeah, they put up a fight. They definitely put up a fight. And it was kind of, you know, we kind of questioned their decision to try and go for overtime, but they were still able to get, what, 4 rounds out of that situation? So
I think if they win just a couple of more rounds, this scoreline could have very easily been something like 16-12 instead, and for Alternate, that's very impressive. Yeah. So, this was a much closer game than it seemed like. Very cool.
No, I was really impressed with how everything went here. But guys, it looks like our next game is going to be Titanel DLC, man.
And we'll be on Mirage.
And I don't have the hat. I don't have the hat.
You don't have the hat. Well, that's not going to help anything anyway, because they're two French teams. French, so right. you'll get it later.
The hat is going to be necessary for tomorrow. I'm going to have to figure out how to get it. Okay.
Please stay tuned, guys. We will be right back. It's going to be a 5-minute break, so don't go anywhere. Titan and LDLC. Remember, this match is to decide essentially who made the right choice in picking sides when it came to the whole French Revolution. So stick around. We'll be right back.